Good morning, good afternoon, good evening everyone, wherever you are, and welcome to this another session of presenting about induction process heating. I am Bhaskar Vairamohan, project manager with EPRI, and currently manage industrial energy efficiency related projects. Without much introduction, let's go into the topic for the day, induction heating. In today's webinar, we will be covering some of the basics on what are various heat transfer modes, some understanding about induction heating fundamentals, not only heating but how it applies to melting, some of the applications of induction heating in the industry, case studies and benefits of electrotechnologies. Not necessarily only energy efficiency related, but there are several non-energy related benefits that the industrial customers like very much. So we will cover them and then summarize the presentation. Before that, a quick introduction about EPRI. EPRI is an independent non-profit organization that performs collaborative work bringing together scientists, engineers, academic researchers, industry experts all around the globe to solve the society's problem faced by the industry and as well as society. In the US, if you look at how much energy is used by the industries, and if you do a breakdown of the energy use, you will notice that nearly 21% of energy, meaning natural gas, electricity, other fossil fuels, and all kinds of energy that is used, goes towards process heating, which is nearly 1/5 of the whole energy use in the industry, which is a major thing. And process heating nearly accounts for 2 to 15% of total industrial production cost in the industry. And when I say process heating, we are talking about temperatures of the processes ranging anywhere from 300 degree Fahrenheit in the lower end to all the way up to 5000 degree Fahrenheit at the upper end. Of the 21% of the process heating energy use, if you look at how much electricity is consumed, only about 12% of electricity is consumed by process heating. And why I am particularly mentioning about electricity is induction heating is electrotechnology, electricity based technology. You can see other things, that other areas that use electricity, such as machine drives, lighting, process cooling, and other areas. So in US, at least 100 billion kilowatt hours or so is used and goes towards process heating. And where, which industries use electricity mostly? And a survey done by EPRI not long ago in 2010 found out that primary metal manufacturing is the largest electricity user in the US. Followed by non-metallic product, fabricated metal product, and so on. And we can see a similar trend in the European countries and other countries as well, because primary metal manufacturing is a very energy intensive application. And the reason why I am bringing up this information before talking about induction is that induction heating finds many application in the top electric usage part of the industry. For example, primary metals and fabricated metals and other areas, induction heating finds a great fit. Taking you all back to high school days to talk about heat transfer modes, just to give an overview of where induction heating falls in. There are three different ways heat could be transferred. One is through conduction, second convection, and third by radiation. And conduction is a process where heat transfer occurs when adjacent atoms vibrate against one another, whereas in convection, the transfer of heat occurs via mass flow, dominant form of heat transfer in liquids and also in gaseous state. Radiation is a process where transfer of heat energy happens through the transfer of photons in electromagnetic waves. In the last seminar, we looked at infrared heating, which falls under the radiation technology. Typical natural gas convection oven happens through convection, where the natural gas heats up the air, and the air heats up, heated hot air heats up the pot. Whereas in induction technology that we are going to see, primary mode of heat transfer is through conduction. Looking at this picture, just to give you a background of what happens in an induction heating. Induction heating makes use of the famous Ohm's law used in electricity. Ohm's law states that the amount of power dissipated in a part is proportional to the square of the current times the resistance of the part, and V is directly proportional to current. The voltage is directly proportional to current. And this current, because it is squared, the amount of heat generated in the part could be huge. A typical induction heating system has a transformer which takes a network frequency of 60 Hertz in US, 50 Hertz in Europe, and converts into goes through a frequency converter and makes it a low voltage, high current system with a varying frequency, and then passes that current to the inductor. Because if you see this picture on the right corner, you can see wherever the coil is surrounded by the part, or the part is surrounded by the coil, the part gets heated. So it is very localized heating process. And this method of heating is called direct heating, where the workpiece is heated, not the surrounding area, including gas or air. You may wonder, can this process only be used for metals? No. This process could be used not only for metals, but plastics and other non-conductive materials. It happens by first heating a metallic part, which is conductive in nature, and then the heat is then transferred to the other materials or object to be heated, such as plastic. Example, chocolate melting happens in a big cauldron. A cauldron is first is a conductive material, and the cauldron is first heated through the induction coil, and when the solid chocolate chunks are put into the cauldron, it melts. So that's one quick example of how induction could be used. So there are two different types of induction heating. One is direct induction heating, where the part itself is heated in the first or the first place, and then there is this indirect induction heating. And you can see the example of coils on the right side of the slide. One thing you may see is that they are not always circular or cylindrical in nature. The coil could be any shape that fits the part. And that's why they are called as a single slot or channel or proximity coils. And this kind of direct induction heating is primarily used in metal industries for melting, heating, and heat treatment areas. And what is indirect induction heating? In induction heating, the same electromagnetic field is applied to an electrically conducting material called a susceptor, which in turn heats the actual object to be heated. A quick example is in US what you see is cash for gold or pawn stores, where they get broken jewelries, ornaments and things like that, and they quickly melt it. And they and what they have inside is a small scale induction, direct induction melters. And when the, they can melt quickly the broken rings and chains, etc., into a gold ingot or silver ingot. So those are some of the examples of how indirect induction heating is applied. Also, it can be used for non-conductive chemicals, plastics, and other things such as even silicon. In the first half of the slide, let's cover some of the induction heating application, before going into the melting application. Induction heating primarily is applied to heat treatment of metal parts. But in order to understand what that process is, I would like to go through a few slides on covering the basics of what is heat treatment, what are the various processes involved within heat treatment, to better understand how induction is applied in those industries. Heat treatment as a technology can be very broadly defined as a process involving controlled heating and or controlled cooling of a workpiece. This is done in order to develop a good amount of strength of either physical or mechanical improvement in the properties. So there are three steps involved in heat treatment. The first step is heating the workpiece to a specific temperature, in order of thousands of degrees. And in second place, the workpiece is held at the same temperature for certain amount of time enough for the transformation in the grain level or atomic level transformation happens. And third, it's the part, the workpiece, is cooled at a prescribed rate to develop the required strength for the material. So there are three processes that are predominant in heat treatment. One is annealing. And annealing is a treatment that heats the workpiece to a high temperature and holding it at a suitable temperature and followed by cooling at an appropriate rate. You can see the graph on the right side, which shows how the workpiece is heated to a certain temperature, and then during the heating cycle it is held at the same temperature for certain duration, and then it is cooled at a certain rate. And to cool the part at different rates, a process of quenching is used. And in quenching means cooling the part rapidly with either oil or gaseous quenchants. The medium can be liquid or gas, and gas-based quenchants are as good as the liquid-based quenchants. Helium, argon, nitrogen are used for gaseous quenchants, whereas oil, water, or aqueous polymer solution is used as a liquid quenchant. And another process within the heat treatment industry is tempering. Tempering is defined as a process in which a previously hardened material is heated to a temperature below the lower critical temperature and then cooled at a rate that will increase the strength, toughness, and the ductility of the workpiece. The graph below in the slide shows the first part, which is annealing, and then you see the second part where the workpieces are taken to a temperature lower than the heating cycle and then held at the same temperature and then quenched to come to a room temperature. And tempering can also be performed by different means, and induction equipment can very well suit this industry. So those are some of the heat treatment processes that we saw, but now we will see how induction technology could be used in those categories for either annealing or tempering or other heat treatment process and surface treatment process. Induction heating happens, as I said, is a localized process. Whenever there is a coil surrounding the workpiece where heat needs can be directly applied to that part. And this process can be used for uniform surface hardening, localized surface hardening, tempering, and thorough hardening. And one thing to note is that the depth of penetration of heat can be very finely controlled with induction heating. The equation below shows the depth of penetration, which is D, capital D, for subscript P, which is directly proportional to 1 over the square root of frequency. Or in other words, the depth is inversely proportional to the square root of frequency. So by increasing the frequency, the depth of penetration of heat could be reduced as much as thin as needed. So the part could be either heated thoroughly to the core or can be heated only on the surface. Where this becomes very favorable is that when you are heating a gear in an automobile part, the gear needs to be heated only at the tip of the tooth in the gear and the valley of the tooth to provide the strength so as the tooth don't break or the teeth don't break. And because in the traditional way, the whole gear part is heated uniformly, whereas that is it's a waste of heat because we need the heat applied only to the tip of the teeth and the valley. So by using induction hardening and varying the frequency, we can heat the tip as well as the valley. So induction heating is applied and primarily in many energy intensive applications, and the primary reason is that it has a very high power density. What do I mean that is that the amount of power applied per square meter or per square centimeter is very higher compared to natural gas based technology. You can see the highlighted row which shows induction has 5000 watts or 5 kilowatt per centimeter square. So that much amount of heat could be imparted into that part. So the effect of that is that a part could be heated in a fraction of a second as opposed to hours or minutes in traditional way, which results in an increase in the productivity. So what are traditional or what are the typical induction heating applications? Induction heating could be applied in various parts, and many places automobile equipment use induction heating quite a bit. And you can see gears, shafts, valves, machine tools, bearing races are heated by induction. In fact, I had a chance to visit one of the automobile manufacturing facility recently, and they were using induction for hardening the crankshafts. And the time taken to harden the crankshaft was less than 2 seconds. So each second, every 2 seconds, the part heated and moves to the next step. So it's very fascinating to see how fast the heat could go to the part. Also, spring steel chain, aluminum strip, and wide variety of application in industries. Lot of application in food processing also is there. So there are quite a lot of applications. Some other additional applications are in rolling, extrusion, upsetting, forging, forming. In melting, you have ferrous and non-ferrous materials melting, even for sand to silica. And then investment casting is where you use gold or silver, and those casting is also there. Hardening, tempering, annealing, normalizing, and stress relieving in the heat treatment industry can be easily done with induction heating. A study done by BNP Market is shown here. It shows what are the types of parts being heated and what is the split up when surveyed different manufacturing facilities. And can be seen gears by far are one of the largest segment of heat treatment application of induction heating. But you also see crankshafts, front wheel components, axles, pins, rivets, fasteners. Those are very quickly done with induction heating. And application of heating is primarily 70% of the folks said in the, they use it for heat treatment as opposed to other method of using induction heating. So heat treatment is by far one of the leading areas of application for induction heating. And here is an example or a case study of how having dual frequency gear hardening helps harden the gear. So as I told earlier, you can see in the picture on to your right lower column, there is a teeth and the valley. And the shaded area is the area to be hardened. In typical ways, they were using just one medium frequency induction system to heat thoroughly the entire gear assembly. Whereas with the dual frequency, they were able to achieve the same thing in reducing the time. Initially, for example, they were using 25 kilohertz system for 2.8 seconds to have a complete heat treatment. Whereas with dual frequency, they first take it to a 3 kilohertz frequency and heat it for 1.8 seconds and then apply a very high frequency of 150 kilohertz and have a very thin layer of heat applied for just 0.18 seconds. And within less than 2 seconds, like 1.98 seconds, they were able to complete the same hardening. And you may wonder, 2.8 seconds to 1.98 seconds is not much difference, but in industrial world, this is a huge deal. Cutting down wherever possible any time saved is increases in productivity and affects the bottom line of the company. So these are some of the benefits of using induction hardening systems. Let's take a look at what are the energy savings opportunities for the induction heat treatment systems. Instant on-off. And this is a great advantage of induction heating systems. When not in use, the power supplies can be turned off, and instantly when you turn it on, it starts working. So there is no preheating required. You may wonder where this is beneficial. I was at a plant and was talking to a plant manager, and he said when they use natural gas-based systems, there has to be somebody who is always near the system during break time or lunch time or whatnot. There has to be somebody there. They cannot leave the natural gas system unattended. Because if they turn it off, it takes at least an hour to few hours to come back to the set temperature and set conditions. Whereas advantage of this is you can turn the system off during a break and then come back on and turn it on, and instantly it starts working. So that's a great benefit. Rapid heating of parts. Induction heating applies because of its high power density. It can heat the part very quickly in a fraction of seconds. And because of that, there is a big benefit. Traditionally, when you want to heat a part, it has to sit in a natural gas batch oven or batch furnace to soak in the heat. And typically, it takes 4 to 8 hours to get the part completely heated. Whereas with induction, the system could be converted into a continuous process as opposed to batch process, and the system could be automated, and by doing that you are increasing the productivity as well. So those are some of the benefits you can when you come back and look at the impacts of induction heating. Scale, scrap loss reduction, and remelting loss reduction. Because induction could use shorter heating times, this results in a lower scrap and scale formation. when you have a long time for heating a material, there is a great amount of chance for having the top layer in contact with oxygen to get it oxidized, and that is the iron oxide or the oxide on the surface of the workpiece is called a scale. And by having a very shorter time for heating, the scale could be reduced and the scrap loss could be reduced. Because there are less scrap and scale, typically what is used to remelt, in the remelting, that energy is also reduced, so there is no remelting. And because we are not heating the surrounding space and just heating the part which is very localized in nature, no lower energy costs are possible, and there is no off-cycle heating losses. So these are some of the energy related benefits. Some of the non-energy benefits are ease of automation. As I mentioned, moving from a batch furnace to a continuous furnace and having it automated, having a compact footprint. The coil size could be adjusted to any shape of the part to be treated and could have a very compact footprint. And in fact, in one plant, the plant manager said they had a huge 2,000 square feet area allocated for natural gas based system. And they were able to reduce nearly 90% and use only 10% of that space for setting up the induction heating. So it may not happen in all the cases, but in some cases, even up to 90% savings in footprint could be used, could be achieved, which is significant in industry. Any amount of real estate is valuable there. Precise application of heat, easier process control and monitoring, and no on-site emissions with the induction heat treatment. These are very essential when we are looking at non-attainment areas where there are environmental regulations to avoid any amount of emissions. Induction could be a great fit. So we conclude the first half on induction heating and applications. In the next few minutes, let's take a look at how induction is used for induction melting. The induction melting, in essence, operates as a transformer, similar to a transformer. In a transformer, if you go back to the high school days and look at the transformation, the current induced in the secondary coil is proportional to the amount of current and the number of windings in the primary coil. So a similar effect is used in the melting. And in the case of induction melting, the induction coil acts as a primary coil having many turns, as you can see in this drawing. And the charge or the raw material that needs to be melted acts as a secondary coil with just one turn. So the primary coil has many turns and the secondary coil has one turn. So the amount of current induced in the secondary is proportional to the primary number of primary coil times the current. So you have a huge amount of current flowing within the charge. So a larger current is induced, and this current by Ohmic law, I squared times R is creating that heat within the charge to impart that power to melt these materials. So once the metal is molten, the magnetic field causes the molten metals to go through a natural stirring process. As you see in this picture on the right side, within the molten metal, there is a movement of metal shown in a closed loop. And these are induced current within the secondary, which forms a closed loop current. And this natural stirring helps to keep the molten metal in a uniform temperature. Technically, in a natural gas furnace, what happens is the heat is applied on the surface, and if you look at the cross section of the molten metal, there is a layer or a stratification of temperature, and the metal has to be stirred through a mechanical process or some other fashion to make it uniform. But in the case of the induction melting, there is no need to do that because of the natural stirring process that occurs because of the induction principle. There are two distinct induction melting furnaces that are available. One is called the coreless induction furnace, and the second one is called the channel induction furnace. And what you see in this picture is a coreless melting furnace. So some of the features of this coreless induction furnace are: this furnace is surrounded by a coil and then covered by a refractory material, and you can see the cross section of the coreless furnace here, and you can see a spout. So once the metal is completely molted, once the metal is melted, then it can be poured into a ladle to take it to a casting site where they can cast it, cast all the molten metals. And the operation frequency can range anywhere from 60 hertz to more than 1200 hertz. And it uses a power supply to change the frequency as needed. And it is best suited for melting small clippings, turnings, and for simple charging and pouring. So one of the drawback, if you think about it, is that a big chunk of metal or a big block of ingot cannot be melted easily. The easier way to do is to chip those big blocks into a smaller parts, and that could be easily melted. So it needs a smaller turnings and clippings for as a raw material in order to melt. That's one of the drawback, but it has several advantages. The furnace can be completely emptied to change an alloy, so every time you can put a fresh feed, and the molten metal can be completely removed. There is no need or requirement to have the molten metal within the furnace, and it can be sized to meet different melting needs. So it can range from 300 pound small ones to 3 tons larger ones. So anywhere in between you can size it to meet the needs of the foundry, and they are very efficient compared to fossil fuel based furnaces. In contrast to coreless, channel induction furnaces are typically more than more than a ton capacity. They are a very higher volume capacity, and you see a cross section of the channel induction furnace at the lower bottom, and where you saw the red color is the molten metal, and you see a channel in the shape of a U, and that that gives the name channel induction furnace. And it has a channel where the molten metal continuously goes and have a constant stirring of molten metal, and the coil is inside the channel, inside the U channel, as you can see the coils. And contrary to the coreless induction furnace, this furnace always has molten metal. The reason is this, because of the channel, this has to be continuously on, and this is used as a way to keep the molten metal, and they called it a holding furnace. The holding furnace is one that keeps the metal at the same molten temperature for further use or future use. And because of the nature of the channel, it will not be turned off. And what happens if we turn it off is that once the molten metal becomes solid, then it is a big block of metal, then it cannot be melted with induction application. We need to, they call it skull formation, and they have to break away the metal to completely remove the metal to make it, bring it into operation, which is a very painful process. And what typically the plants do is that they keep a minimum amount of, they keep it at a standby mode of operation and keep it on even during the weekend and continuously over the period of the year. And if for some reason they have to shut this furnace, they first empty the molten metal and then they turn it off, because otherwise it would be a huge problem. But they have a very high efficiency and extremely effective at mixing the molten metal to get a uniform mixture, and primarily function as a holding furnace. Energy efficiency of various furnaces are listed here. You can see that the bottom two are induction melting, which can have tremendously higher efficiency compared to the natural gas counterparts. But one point I would like to focus your attention on is the metal loss. You can see the fourth column shows the metal loss. For natural gas, it is 3 to 5% metal loss, which is called the dross or slag. They remove it from the surface of the molten metal because there is an oxide formation on the surface which they have to remove. And this is a costly process because 3 to 5% of the metal's cost is taken away as a waste. Whereas in induction melting, you see it's less than 1%. And when you look at several tons of metal to be melted in an annual basis, this 5% could be a significant amount of cost for the industry, and using the induction could reduce that wastage. And newer systems have higher efficiencies. This is efficiency figures from 2000, but there are some since then there are a lot of improvements in both the natural gas and the induction, so we will see a slightly higher numbers than what we are seeing here. So this table is quite interesting and important to note how much energy is required to melt per ton of metal. It may not be generally assumed that all metals and all alloys consume the same amount of energy to melt. That's not the case. Each metal or alloy uses a different kilowatt hours energy to melt for a ton of metal. As an example, the cast iron takes about 619 kilowatt hours to melt 1 ton, whereas in the case of, let's say, silver uses only 235 kilowatt hour per ton. So there is a different variations of the energy use, so it should be kept in mind while designing the system. Let's take a quick look at some of the benefits of the induction melting. Some of the energy benefits: they are very high energy efficient systems and typically range from 55 to 75% and higher than the traditional combustion process. And no preheating of furnace is required as in the case with natural gas, so you save the energy for preheating. Natural mixing or stirring action eliminates stratification and results in a uniform molten metal temperature. So that's another plus point. And there are, as I mentioned, there are improvements happening in the industry on the induction heating technology. The power supplies that are used in the induction systems, they have been at 80% or so efficiency when they got started in 1967. However, if you look at the efficiency that are achievable now, they can go all the way up to 98%, which is significantly high. So they have made some strides in the efficiencies in the power supplies, mostly due to the development in power electronics and also the cooling technologies. And also, in the past, when we need to melt the metal, when the induction system comes on, typically it was not allowed to go to full power, full rated power. So it was slowly increased in steps to reach to the maximum power. So what you see in blue color, where it took about 80 minutes for a complete melting process. Whereas now there are systems that can instantly go from zero to maximum rated power and then melt the metal even quicker. So you can see about 55 minutes. So nearly 25 minutes could be saved because of the way the power is applied to the induction melting system. So these are some of the improvements that are that the manufacturers of the induction systems are constantly working on and trying to bring to the forefront. Some of the non-energy benefits: it has a higher yield because of the absence of combustion sources, reduce the induction furnace reduce oxidation losses or the draws or metal losses, and can have a very high yield. Faster startup, induction furnaces can take up full power instantly and thereby reducing the time reached to working temperature. Better product, induction furnaces allow precise control because of the control system they have, and they can apply frequency variations to make sure the system is optimized, and also they, because of the natural stirring, they have a uniformity of temperature, thereby giving a better product quality. And some of the additional non-energy benefits could be compact installations, better working environment, very flexible, because they can start from raw materials instead of having to have a molten metal to start with. So this gives the flexibility to start having a cold start, so to speak. And these are some of the other non-energy benefits. So let's quickly run through a case study where a manufacturer of railroad bearing was having a bottleneck. The production or demand was higher, but they were spending more amount of energy, and also the cost, maintenance costs were high. So they were trying to go from a traditional gas-fired operation to induction system. So on discussion with induction equipment vendors, they found out having a five new system could help solve the problem. So they installed the system, and these are some of the results obtained from their the case study. Because of the induction system, they were able to have a cost savings per 10, the order of 20 to 30%, and the payback was less than 1.25 years. But when you look at item number 6, the cost, the total cost was 600,000, which is very huge. However, because of various processes and losses that are involved in the system and the maintenance cost, etc., they were able to reduce all that and have a less than a 2-year payback, which is significantly high. And because of the induction system, they reduced the scale loss and the scrap loss by nearly 75%. And the maintenance cost reduced by 50%, and operating labor reduced by 50%. And this goes to say that sometimes the technology, the first cost could be high, but if there is a way, if there is an incentive from utility or through government to offset that, or if the industry has a industrial customer has the budget to go for it, then they can yield better results. So with that, I would like to provide you some references on the topic that we have discussed so far, and.